How's it going, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the 4-1 podcast. It's your host, Matt Leach. We are so pumped about today's episode. We have on Brent Ulrich from our team. How long have you been here at Life Center, man?
Well, I've been on staff for, I think it's about 5 years, but okay. Been kind of playing on the worship band. I mean, yeah. I think the first time Nathan asked me was 2010, 2011. So like 12 years, I guess now.
It's crazy. It's weird because yeah. I was just about to say like X amount of years and I was like, wait, I actually don't know.
Yeah, it's crazy. Time goes fast, man.
It's so nuts. Fast. It's so fun. We were just talking on before we started recording, talked about how we are officially over just 1 year of doing these podcasts, doing the 411 podcast. So it's really been fun. Hope you're enjoying. If you're listening, if you're watching, however you get your podcast, we appreciate you tuning in. So we're officially over the 1 year mark, which is
kudos
super
to you, man.
Thanks,
yeah, I mean,
man.
That's hard.
It's fun. It's
you
got
to make boring people sound interesting.
Especially on camera. No, yeah. Anyways, it's been really great. But yeah, we have some really great episodes in store, and including yours, man. Let's just jump right in. So sure. 12 years, you can even back it up even further than that for us. What we've basically been doing, which you know you've listened to is a bunch of these, and telling people stories and, you know, kind of interweaving their testimonies with it. We had on Rusty and Mia Fuller yeah. not too long ago.
Amazing.
And they mentioned they go way back with you.
But oh, yeah.
Go ahead, man. Like, you know, give us some of your background.
Yeah.
Just I mean, up here.
Sure. So, I mean, if we go way back, I was born into a church. Basically, my parents founded a church in yeah. Ephrata called Ephrata Community Church with a few other couples, like when they were in their, I don't know, probably early 20s or something. So I was kind of born into that church as a PK. You can relate to that,
yeah,
right?
Totally.
So we got the PK thing. My dad was a worship leader for like almost the entirety of the time the church has existed. So I don't even know how long it is, 40, 50 years, something like that.
Okay.
And just recently retired. And my mom has done admin there for almost the entirety of the church too.
Wow,
so just kind
yeah.
of just crazy, crazy servants really built the thing up. But because of that, I was always around music, you know, always kind of drawn to that. My dad always had a guitar lying around, so I'd pick it up and strum it, and kind of always had a natural attraction to that, and kind of a natural, somewhat of a natural ability, just like at a very rudimentary level. So I think because of the instant gratification that you get from having some natural ability, it's like, oh yeah, this is cool and I can do it. I want to pursue this,
totally.
You know, that kind of a thing.
Totally, yeah.
So there was that. Yeah, so then that takes you kind of into the teenage years where you start getting a little bit more serious about music because you realize the potential that it has. And I mean, honestly, like music is a pretty crazy thing. Like it,
yeah.
it's like there's nothing else like it. I mean, it's like any art, I guess, but like there's something so unique when you like grab a guitar and you like strum a chord and like, wow, I produced something that didn't exist and I like brought it into existence. And then it takes it to a whole nother level when you do that with other musicians. There's like yeah. this chemistry that happens. And it's like this high you get almost. So then like as like a teenager experiencing that, you want to pursue that. Like, man, this is what I want to do with my life. This feels amazing. Like cool. you can actually manipulate emotion. Manipulate is probably a bad word, but you can like create tension, and like music is such a powerful communicator of emotion. So I was really drawn to that. So then like, it's kind of the same story as Nathan or Rusty or a lot of the veteran musician guys around here. We kind of had the same story where
okay.
in our teenage and maybe early 20s, we pursued bands and we just played out as much as we could. I was in yeah. a band that rehearsed like 4 nights a week in Coatesville and played every weekend and
sheesh.
Then did some small tours and stuff. And each of us were probably in like half a dozen bands or whatever. And that's true for me as well. And, you know, you kind of, it's kind of a rite of passage where you kind of, yeah. you know, I don't know if it's as much today. The whole scene has probably changed a little bit. Back then, there was a very strong music scene where you could have a band, you could play out, and there was actually like a community to support that.
Okay.
And then there's like within certain genres, there's just like people that are, there's like a built-in fan base almost.
Okay. Gotcha.
So it's pretty incredible. So, but we kind of, yeah, I think we view it as kind of like a rite of passage where you had to play in crappy clubs where half the stuff worked. And like I don't know how many times I played shows where I plug my amp in and it's just not working because the power is all messed up in the venue. So, but I kind of feel like that's part of the rite of passage where like, okay. if you can make it through this show and still perform well and like still play your parts well and not let the distractions kind of distract you.
Yeah.
It's poor wording. then it's kind of like, yeah, it builds grit. It's like,
yeah, okay.
The idea of having like this perfect in-ear monitor mix where everything's perfectly separate. It's like, no, you have like the bass is like humming in the corner, your guitar amp's half working and the drums are like overpowering everybody and you're still going to play your show and it's going to be fun and that's what you're there to
People
do.
People will enjoy it. You'll get like good feedback, negative feedback. Right, and it's like a part of the whole
experience.
It's like
a refining thing. It's like, this is what you do. Hey, it's not going to be easy, but this is what we signed up for. It's what we're going to do. We're going to have the grit to do this.
Totally. That's awesome.
So there's that whole thing.
And so that took you, I guess you're jumping ahead a little bit because that's so much that what you just mentioned is like what I wanted to get into, but that was kind of, I guess, I remember Mia saying that was like your late teenage years, early 20s, where it's like you guys were involved in different bands and you're traveling, right? This mm-hmm. It's taking you places.
Yeah, totally.
And how did that kind of, was that a huge chunk of your life or do you feel like looking back, maybe it was a small blip? I guess maybe both.
I mean, it's funny because it wasn't as long as we probably feel that it was, but I think it had the biggest impact on our life of any other period in our life. I think Rusty would say the same thing. I think Nathan might say the same thing. I don't know. But like, I mean, realistically, it was probably like a 5 to 7 year window. Wow. But like the experiences that we got from that, like, I mean, I played Creation like 3 times. I played Purple Door tons of times. And Cornerstone, we traveled all over the country. Yeah. Like those are the memories that you've created in like these. And what I miss most about being a part of that kind of a thing is like there's such a community and this camaraderie. Like your friends were like some of your best friends were your favorite bands, and it's just like you got to play with them and like travel with them and you got to hang out with them and build this kind of relationship. And those I still have like relationships with those guys like decades later.
It's awesome.
Decades later, man. So depressing. Aging is a thing, man. That's real.
That's weird, but I mean, I feel like Nate and I both don't view you that way, if that helps.
No, that's good. Thanks. Still, yeah. I'm a child at heart, right, Nathaniel?
Oh, man. But it is weird to like look back, especially you've been a part of the music industry. And you mentioned, because I was going to ask if like music has been naturally or just always a huge part of your life, which it sounds like it has.
Yeah.
So you've really been in it as the scene and the industry has changed. And industry meaning focusing more on Christian music. Am I right in saying that? Or would you kind of...
Yeah, I would say like some of the bands that I were in, I mean, a few of them specifically were definitely like in the Christian market. We played a lot of youth groups and stuff, but we also tried to like not make it exclusive. We played a lot of clubs as well.
Cool.
And I was in a metal band that was not like necessarily... I mean, it was all Christian members, but we weren't like marketed at that time. It might still be the same way. I don't know. But metal music kind of was like an exception. Like if you played metal, it was kind of like, oh, it's just metal music and you are all playing it. There's some people that were kind of anti that. But for the most part, it was like, we're all in this together. We just play music we love. So it wasn't necessarily Christian. I mean, it definitely wasn't worship music. Like if you're talking about the industry as music today and stuff like that, that's a whole different thing. But
totally.
I just feel like almost a CCM, a Christian, contemporary Christian thing. It almost feels like maybe I don't have a good perspective of this, but it almost feels like it almost doesn't exist. It feels like it's pretty much just worship now.
Yeah. Wow.
Where I know when I was growing up, like there was, you could find any genre of any music and there'd be like Christian artists making that music, but there's like independent record labels to support that. And I don't know if that really exists. I'm sure there's, I might just be out of touch. I am now older as right, Nathaniel. Yeah, he agrees. So maybe it's there and I just, I'm not in tune with it anymore, but that's like the vibe I get.
That's so interesting. And I mean, kind of to intertwine it with your own personal journey, because Rusty and Mia, when they brought this up, it really kind of, for whatever reason, stuck with me. They said that time, like you said, it was formative for your own, I guess, just growing up. Would you say that was like a huge like marking point in your life where you're like...
Yeah, totally.
You know, you kind of found out...
It's a rite of passage.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. And did you find out in this time like, okay, this is something I want to like pursue more, or it's like, okay, I kind of want to pivot from this. I guess, what did you leave that time period or that season of life?
Yeah, I mean, so there's the skill sets that you acquire, which is you now learn how to... You learn what band dynamics are. You learn how to arrange. You learn how to write. You've developed grit. You learned how to work with other people. You learned how to, I mean, if you're in a van with 4 other people for like days, weeks at a time, it's like you're either gonna like you're going to learn some stuff or you're going to like bail. So most of us learned and like, hopefully didn't get too bitter from any of it. But, but then there's like the realization of like, man, this is going to be really hard to make it work long term, unless you're like that 1% that has like that hit song and just crushes it. And like to make a living touring is like a hard thing to do. And, I think that hits home pretty, I think we all recognize that at some point.
Yeah.
And so for me, it was like, I recognized it. And at the point I was kind of after 7 years, you're kind of ready to try some other avenues as well. So okay. I ended up going to a recording school right after all of the band stuff kind of settled down. And I went out, did that. I came back home and I started looking for something that's more audio, like maybe more of a profession, but in the audio world.
Okay.
And that's kind of where I got connected with Claire Brothers.
Okay.
So I was, I just applied not really knowing anything, except for some recording knowledge that I'd gained. And I literally got a job just like screwing speakers into a speaker cabinet when I started. Like,
wow.
But what's crazy about that story is I went in for an interview and the guy who gave me the interview and showed me around was the president of Claire Brothers. And I don't know if that's normal. It doesn't feel like it's normal. It feels like they should have someone handling employment. Yeah.
And if you want to explain Claire Brothers for listeners or for viewers, some might know, some might not.
Yeah. So Claire Global is like the world's largest audio production company in the world. And they had a sister company called, it's actually kind of split into two companies for a while. Now they're back together, but there was an integration division of that also did product development. And that's the side that I got interviewed for. Okay. So the president of that division, he walked me around the whole shop, showed me everything, showed me where the speakers get assembled, showed me where the research and development team was. And then he sits me down at the end of this entire tour and he's like, well, we don't really have any positions open, but you smiled the whole interview and I feel like we could use more of that around here. So we'll hire you.
Wow.
I was like, okay. Whatever like reason to get my foot in the door. Like
absolutely.
I didn't care.
Yeah. That's amazing. Yeah, that's crazy favor too. Yeah, looking back. You
exactly.
Know?
There's awesome. There's like a lot of those stories throughout my life where it's like, oh, this is actual like favor and God opening doors throughout like things that didn't make sense.
So
there's,
cool.
There's tons of them that I won't go into all of them, but
yeah. Okay. So that was, that was kind of how you transformed.
That was a huge pivot
okay.
in my life. And then that was, so I was there for 11 years before I came on staff here at Life Center, but during that time, I kind of went from just a hand screw like speakers into a cabinet to working with the research and development team by the time I ended. And I was actually with them the majority of the time I was there. Once they understood I had some knowledge about the stuff, then they kind of taught me the majority of what I know now as far as like the technical aspects and the topology of sound systems and stuff like that.
Gotcha. Wow.
Yeah. So
11 years there and that's really cool to hear like how you transitioned and then you found, you know, maybe you discovered more during that time, like, okay, yeah, this feels like God, like something I really want to be in did you find you were more passionate about it during your time?
Yeah.
There?
Well, I think what surprised me is I was into audio. I was like, I'm not really into sound systems, but like it's better than my previous job was working at an injection molding company, which is like, that has no tie to my life.
Yeah,
you know, like
totally.
I can take or leave that.
Totally.
So I'm like, well, at least it's somewhat tied in. Maybe I'll learn some cool things. But what I found is the more I learned about it, the more passionate I became about it. It's like, this is actually understanding the stuff. And then that made me more excited about it. And you want to learn more. So it's kind of like awesome. This unintentional momentum built about like just the tech behind what I was already doing.
That's awesome. And then during this kind of the same time where you're working for Claire, did you start playing here? Is that when you started playing maybe Sundays, Wednesdays?
Yep, exactly. So during my time at Claire, I think it was, so my connection point to Life Center, I had known about Life Center. I was actually up here for a Kevin Prosh thing when it was still on like 13th Street.
Yeah.
Like in the old building. That was my memory of Life Center. And then I had been up, I think it had been Brian and Jen Johnson at a Firestorm. I remember being up here pretty early on in the new building. I can't remember. I think it might have been a Firestorm.
Okay.
And I think one of them got sick and then Chris Colallo was leading, but before Jesus culture and all that stuff.
Thing.
Yeah.
Wow,
so
wow.
I don't know, whatever year that was,
sure.
Probably early 2000s.
Yeah.
But around that time, Nathaniel's father over here, I ran into him because our bands would play together. Right. So I knew who Nathan
was.
Ask
this. Okay. Got you.
I knew who Nathan was just as an acquaintance. And a friend of mine got married, Jeremy Fisher.
Yeah.
And I went to his wedding and I didn't know anybody there. It was all Life Center people and me. So like, the only exception was like, I knew the Reasoners. Jess Reasoner, yeah. Jess Aiken now. And then the Fishers, and that was basically it, because I grew up with them.
Gotcha.
So I arrive here and I recognize Nathan, so we kind of connect, and he's like, "Oh, you're into recording? Oh, I'm into recording too." Like we kind of, that was a connection point. We both had just started recording for a couple years at that point.
Okay.
We were both like pretty new and green.
Okay.
And then he introduced me basically to the entire Life Center band at the time. So that was like Ben Shea and Steve-O and Andy Aiken, those kind of guys.
It's awesome.
I was like, wow, okay, cool. Didn't hear anything for like, we exchanged information, didn't hear anything for maybe 2 months. And he randomly texted me. He's like, "Hey, you want to play guitar for this event at Life Center?" I said, "Sure, whatever. Just send me the songs and I'll learn them."
Yeah.
I didn't really get anything. I think I got one demo. I was like, whatever. Okay. I guess I'll just figure it out.
It's crazy.
Classic.
Yeah.
So I showed up, I think it was like a New Year's Eve thing. I feel like Sean Foyt was involved, but I don't remember him being there, but I think that's what somebody said.
Okay.
And I show up to play guitar and there's five worship leaders. It's Nathan, John, Tiff, Ricardo, and Suze. Is that what it was? Or maybe Dave, not Ricardo. Anyway.
Yeah.
But each one of them, I think it was Suze instead of Ricardo for this thing.
Okay.
And all five of them did an original song. So I've never heard any of these songs.
Oh my gosh.
Five songs that I had no context for, except for one demo that Nathan sent me. Yeah. I was like, okay, I guess I'll just stay in the key. Tried to like fill up some space here.
Yep.
And at that point I realized, wow, this is not like a normal thing. Like to have five people each writing their own song, and that each one of the songs was like exceptional. It wasn't like these were like, oh yeah, I can tell this person's just learning the right stuff. They're like, no, this is like quality stuff. And I'm like, what is this? Like most churches would be happy to have one of these five, and we have just five random, and they're all young at the time, and they were probably all like mid-20s or something.
Okay.
It's like, this is incredible. This is such a special thing. So, but that was, at that point I got tied in and I started playing guitar. Then Dave found out I played drums. So then I played drums for a few years and back on guitar. And then kind of got tied into tech after that.
Okay.
And, then eventually came on staff. So
yeah, man.
That's kind of like
talk
the
about
tie.
The transition, I guess, to, I mean, there's so much in there. That's so true about the unique aspect.
It's crazy.
And I feel like at times, I feel like maybe I've said it before, but it's so true. If you have been here a while, you can easily forget. You're like, wow, it actually is super
special
goes on.
Yeah.
Or what, you know, people's talents or giftings, abilities are. It's amazing. Yeah. Totally agree. So yeah, I guess, how did you end up starting to transition into full-time here and head of the entire tech team, engineering, sound, audio, everything, basically.
Yeah, I mean, so I slowly started to transition from playing into more of like a front of house, like sound guy thing.
Okay.
I think that's where there was a need. And so I kind of tried to fill that need. And then after volunteering for a while, just kind of approached with like an offer. And I thought about it for a while. I wasn't sure. Like, I think it might also be kind of a trend with some of us. We're like, we never really intended to work for the church.
Sure.
Like I always loved the church. I have nothing against the church, but like,
totally.
It never was like, as my career path, I want to work for the church.
That's
and
my
it
goal.
Was never, it was never like an intention. It's just, but I'm like, well, if God opens the doors and so they gave me an offer and I prayed about it and I felt peace about it and I felt like I was supposed to do it.
It's awesome.
And so I accepted the offer. And at that point it was just to kind of run the audio division.
Okay.
And, as things progressed, just kind of like started to oversee more of the production aspects in general.
Okay.
To this where
was like 2010, 2011, 2012, maybe?
I think I've been here. It'll be 5 years.
Oh, okay.
On staff.
Okay.
So I don't know what year is it? 2023. Yeah, so
17. I don't know. Wow. 18. It all runs together.
Yeah. So 2018, I think I probably started if my math is correct there.
Okay.
And it's been awesome. I mean, the church is, it's an amazing church and they like really care about making sure people don't get burnt out. They really make sure people are taken care of. It's like a value here.
Yeah.
And it's incredible. Yeah.
So cool. I mean, yeah, you touched on so much of like your journey to get here, talked about a little bit of the industry. And then I guess from now that you've been front of house audio, overseeing all of that.
Yeah.
How do you feel? I mean, technology for sure has just advanced so much over the years. How do you feel like that's affected the worship music, like you said, a lot of it seems to be worship and just like where yeah. it's less of what you grew up with, maybe what you guys grew up playing with the different mm-hmm. types of bands. But now it's just a ton of worship, which isn't a bad thing. It just looks so yeah. different maybe. From an audio or sound perspective, what do you think, like how has it just progressed, or how are you like, wow, this is so much more advanced than anything we had growing?
Yeah, I mean, so there's the industry that's morphed and changed, and then there's the tech that's morphed and changed. Okay. And I think we don't recognize it, but I think it's a reality that they're tied together. I mean, the yeah. reason that the Beatles sounded like the Beatles is because of the technology that they had, and they got the most out of it.
Yeah.
But the reason that the 80s sounded like the 80s was because digital reverb modules were coming out in the 80s, and everybody said, oh, this is the new tech, that's use it. And that's why everyone's snare sounds like a cannon going off, you know, but that's like, you'll see that pattern throughout like okay. the history of music. And I think yeah. it's not any different in modern culture, where we literally have any tool we could want now. We can kind of get any sound we want. So things sound bigger, more impressive, more produced than ever before because the tools are available. And none of that's wrong. I mean, it's all like art, and it's all like worship, and it still comes down to the heart behind it and totally, like, and awesome. The engagement with it.
Yeah,
it's not really the technology is never the problem. It's always, you know, how is it being used? And that's one thing which I like, I try to coach is anytime we're dealing with production, it's there's kind of like, for my compass, there's two questions. It's usually, is this serving the congregation, what we're doing right now? And is this helping to lead people towards an encounter, or is it a distraction?
That's awesome.
And as long as those things align for me, I usually feel pretty good. And it's not necessarily that cut and dry, because anything in production, anything in art, and anything in music, worship, it's all subjective. Every single gotcha. Aspect of what we do is subjective. Right. So that's okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's okay, because we just make decisions, you know, what it sounds like is that could be like, to some people, I think that could come across as, that sounds like the most uncomfortable thing I've ever heard of in my life, where everything is subjective mm-hmm. and everything is up for wow. debate.
Yeah.
And it could be, except you know what trumps all of that? Relationship and that's trust. Good. So if there's relationship and if there's trust, then it doesn't have to be this stressful tension, because you know what the expectation is. And if something isn't resonating right, you can talk about it, that's and there's awesome. A trust there. Like, and that's okay. Like,
that's awesome.
There should always be an open flow of conversation, because we are dealing with subjective things, and everyone is going to have a different opinion, and that's
yeah.
okay.
Yeah. That's
again,
awesome.
It's okay. That's it's just awesome. Like finding kind of the sweet spot and trying to serve. And you know, there's a reputation of sound guys. I don't know if you guys are in tune with this or not, but the reputation is, if you played thousands of clubs, you'll see this, where sound guys have a reputation of being grumpy, right?
Gotcha. Yeah.
And it's because they're always like frustrated that bands aren't prepared, and they don't know what they want, and you know better because you've been doing this longer, all this stuff. But so there's like this reputation that if you go up to a sound guy, it's going to be a poor experience for you, because there's going to be like this, like, get away from me type of thing. But okay. the reality is like, if somebody is coming up to you, people don't just come up to you because they feel like telling you something wrong that they made up. Like I find that there's always a piece of truth. It may seem like you should just dismiss it, but if somebody comes up to me and has some sort of criticism or complaint or something, you need to like weigh that. Like it definitely, there's usually a piece of truth behind every piece of criticism. Like
yeah.
even if you may not agree with the criticism, it's, you have to at least, okay, well, at least let me stand over here where you're standing and see if I can hear what you're hearing and meet them halfway. And like, yeah, they're not trying to annoy you. They literally, like, something's bothering them, and you should try to like recognize what it is, even if you don't agree with the result or the solution. There's a little bit of truth in every piece of, I mean, some people just like to complain. That's the reality too. But for the most part, that's not the case. Most people like care, and they're trying to express something to you, and to just snub them away is like not a good approach. Yeah. And you know, and that also just destroys relationship immediately too. There's no trust there. If someone feels like you're not going to give them the time of day, they're not going to have any respect for you either. But I don't know how I got down that rabbit hole.
No, that's so good. I love that you went down that trail, because you're saying about the relationship aspect being so key. I didn't really think about that before, especially in kind of just sound production type of environment. Yeah, like if you're not in it anyways, and to add on to that even deeper is like relationships are messy. I love what you said about it. It's like, hey, if one guy's, you know, this person's opinion is one X and then yours is Y, it's like, let's talk about it. That's what this is.
Exactly.
And, you know, if we have disagreement, let's figure this out and then move on. Yeah. Keep moving forward from there. But that takes commitment. That takes trust. That takes effort all the way, even like going back all the way to what you said about living in a van with guys for 4 days, with people for 4 days. It's just like, okay, we're going to have to figure this out.
Yeah.
So that's really cool. I love what you said about the relationship aspect. Yeah, it's so true.
It all just comes like you have to approach everything with humility, like you do in any aspect of life. Like it's not any different. It's just, and the good news about a church is there's authority. So ultimately, it's a conversation and I'm listening, but if someone makes a decision, I'm cool. That's the decision.
Yeah,
that makes it easy for me.
It does. It helps.
I'll do whatever you tell me to do. Like I'm here to serve, you know?
It helps a lot. Man. Yeah. I love that answer. That's really cool. And it's really cool insight. Which is what I was hoping to get from you in this episode, of just insight into kind of what goes on. Man, what does that guy do at the sound booth?
Yeah, what do I do? I don't know.
Every Sunday, every Wednesday. So that's helpful. You know what I mean? I'm sure some people are aware, but also they're just gives more of it like an inside, you know, behind closed doors type of view. But
yeah,
you mentioned it earlier, talking about what you're like, your top two things that you try to align with. And if you want to expand on those, I'd love for you to do so. It's like, okay, in this, as you've been here the last 5 or 6 years on staff and you've grown the tech department, it's crazy to see our department. Like we have meetings and you have meetings within meetings and there's so many, the team is so solid and you really oversee it all. And it's grown to be this just healthy, awesome, amazing team. And, I guess I would love for you to expand upon those. And if there's any other principles that you try to apply with when it's like, okay, when we're serving the congregation, what are we trying to do via production and everything that we do that it's involved underneath the tech department?
Yeah. I mean, so Life Center has core values. So, I mean, they kind of already have the infrastructure in place and it's just kind of reinforcing those. Like, we can do things with joy, even if it's not necessarily something that's fun to do because it's a choice and like we get to do that. So it's just some of it's coaching and like, hey, let's make sure we have a good attitude about this. Or like that's, and a lot of it's just checking in with people like, hey, how are you doing this week, man? Like, are you doing okay? Good. Do we need to talk about anything? Like, is something like weighing on you? And, it's just caring and loving for people. And we have like, a big part of it is we like have Robbie and Allison who are like the dream team as
amazing,
well. I mean, I say that, but like literally every aspect of all of our tech staff are the dream team. Even Nathaniel over here.
Seriously, though.
He's amazing. Like everybody's amazing. Like if you talk to anyone on staff that's part of the tech team, there's not a weak link. Like it's every single person is amazing. Whitney is like the best ever. Like Daniel's amazing. Totally. Andrew's amazing. You'll never hear it like anybody say like negative things. Ryan Viazzi, he's the first guy that the band meets when they come onto the stage and he's happy.
Yep.
Like he's pleasant. He like has all their stuff ready for them. And like, that's a huge part of it. And it's just like, I feel like people give me credit for it, but like the team is just like, the individuals that Life Center has hired has made it so easy for
it's
me.
Amazing,
so
like,
they gave me guys that are just like, love Jesus with all their hearts, that spend time with him every day and come into the building with that on their life.
That's awesome.
And I get to reap the benefits of their personal lives too. I mean, like anything, there's still like a pastoral role there, but I feel like our baseline is so high compared to like some other places that I feel like, man, the hard work is done on a personal level with the individuals that we have on the team. So
true.
I couldn't be happier with our team. It's like,
so cool to see, like you said, like it's, you know, I'm sure viewers or listeners, if you guys are listening to this, you notice it too. It's just that, so many of the people you mentioned, Daniel, Andrew, and Whitney, it's like whoever's involved or our camera operators, you know, it's just like everybody, you could tell the level of excellence or the level of commitment that they're like, wow, this is so awesome that the congregation, that people are getting this experience on a Wednesday night or they're encountering the Lord on a Sunday. Like that comes out of them. It's really cool. It comes out of everybody on our team. And
when you have people as happy and as joyful as Robbie and Allison, like all of the camera operators under them are going to be happy too.
It's awesome.
They just feel like, oh, this is a party. Like, this is great. Like, we love this. Like, we feel loved and appreciated. And like it never feels like a grind when they're around because they're so pleasant to be around. And it's just like, man, it's It's amazing.
Yeah.
Could not be happier.
That's awesome, man. Yeah. It's so cool. And it's a good point about, like, saying the example of, like, Ryan Biazzi, like, 6 a.m. rehearsal, like, on a Sunday morning. Yeah. He is the first guy they see.
Yeah, right in the door. There he is, standing, staring at him.
If he's going to be in, like, this awful mood every time, it is going to affect everything.
Yeah, and I've worked in those environments. I mean, we just actually, I don't want to, like, say specific.
Sure. But
the band just recently was in an environment like that, not, like, last year when we had to do a gig somewhere. And it's like, wow, one person on the team can make everybody shift the entire dynamic to go from, like, joy to, like, tension. Like, it's crazy. Wow. Like, one person can do that, especially if it's the person directly working with the band.
Yeah.
That's so amazing. That's like huge. It's a huge value for the church too. And I mean,
that's awesome.
We're talking about the tech team right now, but if you just walk through the office at Life Center, it goes true with all of the staff.
Yeah.
I mean, you'll never meet like more pleasant people in your life. Talk to Don Locke and tell me if like you won't walk away just feeling happier about life. Like,
totally.
It's incredible. Like Marcy and it's you amazing. And like everybody, it's like everyone. Everyone is just pleasant. The stocks, the leeches, everybody is like happy all the time.
Totally.
I'm probably the least happiest person in the whole building. And I like,
it's, it is true, man.
I'm usually too like, I tend to get like, like focusing on something and I feel like my natural
you're zeroed in
face is not a joyous one, but I try to
no I would agree
I try
with
to
you.
Resist
focused
that. Focus you would agree
word.
With me that I'm the least pleasant person in the building. I got it.
focused yeah, that's great, man. I think that's just so awesome. I mean, is there, we don't have to get too into the weeds because that's also an amazing part, like place to stop at, but is there anything, you know, kind of that you want to add about, like, you know, I think I was, my main goal in this episode was just to give people a sneak peek of like, okay, what really happens, you know, what are these guys doing on a weekly basis that maybe enhances the production of everything, the lighting, the sound.
Oh,
and, yeah,
I mean,
there's
Sundays probably 15 people on tech every service, I would say, something like that.
It's amazing. Because
what people don't see is there's like Tom's over in the first wave mixing kids there, and then there might be a youth band rehearsal happening in the youth room.
Yeah.
And then there's going to be a monitor guy and lighting guy and LED wall guy. And there's projectionist. Make sure, like, Whitney makes sure the lyrics are all up on the screen. It's a hard job. Like, she knows the songs better than the band does.
Yep.
She is the one letting the band know what words to sing next. Like, she's important.
Exactly.
And there might be like 6 or 7 camera operators and then a director and a producer and a broadcast engineer. And there's like, there's a massive team behind the scenes that doesn't have a lot of face value. That like really makes the whole thing happen. It's not like one or two people. It's like it's a full team, and it's
amazing.
And they're all aces. They're all amazing. And like we're talking about staff and tech, but the volunteer base at Life Center, they're all gems as well. Like I could not sing higher of the praises of the volunteers, the families that come to Life Center, the families of Life Center, the staff. I mean, it really is the dream.
It's awesome.
It's amazing.
So true, man.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming on. Thanks for giving us some
totally,
time.
Yep.
Yeah, just giving us a little sneak peek about, you know, your life, how you got here, and then the team as well. It's really special.
Awesome. Hopefully you guys can wake up now. It's over. You can move on to the next one.
Thanks again, man. Appreciate
the
time.
Yeah, awesome, dude. Thanks for having me on.
All right, welcome back to another segment of The Rumor on 411. And I really hope you guys enjoyed, you know, just a little bit of a sneak peek. We were talking once we finished recording of other things that we meant to cover that didn't, but, you know, conversation just flows a certain way. And you know, we can always have Brent back on, which definitely plan to. But I did want to note, and the reason I brought up in saying that we just passed our 1 year, I guess you could say, of doing 1 year anniversary, 1 year of doing this, of the season one, 411 podcast. We will kick off season 2 next week. I'm really excited. Actually, it might be the first week of May now that I say that, but stay tuned for someone who, you know, it's probably the big elephant in the room who we haven't had on yet, who I'm super excited to have on, and who a lot of you guys, listeners, viewers, hear from often on Sundays, but we're excited to have him on the podcast. Just get a ton of stories from him and what's going on. And so that'll be in the coming weeks. Stay tuned. But man, it's been such a fun year plus of doing this. I didn't even think about it until, you know, probably after Ricardo White's episode last week. I was like, wow, we've been doing this for a year. And I know I have had some people ask me and reach out to me. Hey, I can only see from episode 11 on YouTube where the first 10 episodes. We only did, to give you, if you're just, you know, joining us the last couple episodes, we only did our first 10 episodes, we only did audio. So if you want to go to Spotify, if you want to go to Apple Podcasts, wherever you get and listen to your podcast or listen to podcasts, feel free to go there. You can also go to lcmi.org. And if you scroll down towards the bottom of the page, you'll see a graphic, our 411 podcast graphic. You can click on that. It'll actually take you right to all 42 episodes of the 411 podcast that we've done so far. So if you're interested in any of those first 10 episodes and want to, yeah, just see who we interviewed those first 10, feel free to do that. Again, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or go down to lcmi.org, bottom of the page. It's all there. And then, yeah, if you're someone who watches them, all of them from episode 11 are on our YouTube channel at Life Center Ministries. So yeah, really excited, guys. Thank you for, you know, continuing with us, staying with us. It's been so fun learning about so many of our staff, so many of just people within our congregation, just stories after stories. And we're not even, you know, we're not even getting to everything we could cover in these people's lives. But I really wanted to set, you know, the first year or so of just a lot of people's backgrounds. And it's like, wow, okay, I know so much more about Brent, or I know so much more about Rusty and Mia. And like, I see Rusty drumming all the time, but like, oh, I didn't know he was in all these crazy bands, or, you know, they're just like, they were lived a whole life in San Diego. Just amazing tidbits. Cause, you know, in my opinion, once you learn that people have lived some life, they've lived a lot of life and they've been through a lot of things, a lot of highs, a lot of lows, just really gives you even more empathy for them. And, you know, helps you understand people's perspectives and people's viewpoints on life, and helps you, as Brent mentioned in this past episode, it's like, man, it helps you build relationship more with people when you understand what they've been through, or yeah, what's going on in their lives currently. So that was my whole goal for season one, at least. And we'll probably shift gears a little bit here starting in over the next year in season two of the podcast. It's been so special, but we'll get into some more maybe concepts, some topics, maybe have, you know, the podcast be more topic focused. Just stay tuned for a lot of it. Looking ahead here at Life Center, I don't know if I talked about this last week after Ricardo's episode on the Rumor on 411 segment, but one thing I do want to highlight coming up Sunday, April 30th, Sean Foy is going to be with us here speaking at both our 9 and 11 a.m. services on Sunday, April 30th. Cannot wait. We just announced it this past Sunday, and like, you know, in our weekly announcement video that we do, and I know we had a bunch of people in the congregation who were fired up by that. Sean's just such a great friend, close friend, Charles and Ann, and a bunch of the staff members here. Yeah, we just really appreciate when Sean comes through, and that, you know, what the Lord has put on his life and on his heart to carry. And yeah, we really appreciate and respect all that he does for the kingdom. So he's coming Sunday, April 30th. You can watch online, but there's nothing like being here in the room. But I think that's all I'll focus on for now. We have a lot more coming in May, but just wanted to highlight that coming up at the end of April. Thank you guys for joining us, as always. If you want to share this, feel free to share it with your friends, family, via YouTube, via Spotify, via Apple. You can give us a rating and review on Spotify, I believe, or leave us comments on YouTube about what you're enjoying. We are looking forward to our next season. Thank you all for season one. We'll be back for season two. Thanks, guys.